Hello, welcome to Free Bible Commentary with Pastor Teacher Dr. Bob Utley. Be sure to visit Free Bible Commentary at www.freebiblecommentary.org. Now, here's Bob.
Well, we're going to start with the six churches today. We finished one last week with the introduction. I hope that was helpful to you. Now let's go to the church at Smyrna, beginning in chapter 2, verse 8. Now, notice it starts out, the first and the last. This, again, is a title for Jesus that's found in chapter 1. This is originally a title for Yahweh. It's used in Isaiah 41:4, 44:6, and 48:12, who was once dead but came to life. Now, that seems to me to relate to Jesus mentioned in chapter 5, verse 6, as the Lamb that was slain but is now alive. It's the idea of his substitutionary death and resurrection. Notice it says in verse 9, I know your pressing trouble and poverty. These are strong Greek terms. They were under real persecution. And the poverty here is the strongest word for poverty. That's unusual because Smyrna was a very wealthy city. Obviously, economic poverty was part of what was happening. Notice it says, but you are still rich. You just can't judge Christian people by what they have, because these folks were rich in faith. I know how you are abused. Now, King James has the word blasphemed, but the word here literally is slandered, and that is etymologically related to the Hebrew word for Satan that's going to be mentioned here. Satan is mentioned in verse 9, the devil in verse 10. Satan is mentioned quite often in the book of the Revelation. We have him mentioned in 2:13, 3:9, 9:11, 12:9 and 10, and 12, 13:4, 20, verses 2, 7, and 10. He is a major theme. The book of the Revelation is primarily not about the how of the second coming, but about the sovereign God that controls all history and is going to bring history to a culmination at the glorification of the saints and the judgment of Satan and his. Now, notice what it says, by those who claim to be Jews, although they are not. Now, over here in chapter 3, beginning in verse 9, a very similar phrase is used. In chapter 3, 9, it's obviously national Israel, or Jewish people, who are claiming that they're really related to God and the Christians aren't. Now, in John chapter 8, verse 44, Jesus called some of the Jewish people that they were of their father the devil. There are several places where if this does refer to natural Jews, we know that it's the spiritual faith of Abraham that God requires. You might want to see Romans chapter 2, verses 28 and 29, Revelation chapter 3. Most of that is significant, I think. And then, let's see, 3:29, and then Galatians 6:16. Galatians 3:29 significant. Galatians 6:16 is also significant. Some have said if it does refer to the Jewish persecution, we have many allusions to that in the book of Acts. Acts 13:50, Acts 14:2, 14:5, 14:19, 17:5. Some say it refers to the Judaizers, like in the book of Galatians. But I really think it's probably the concilia, or the emperor worship, that's being referred to, like in chapter 2, verse 13. Now, notice it mentions then in verse 10, do not be afraid, present imperative of the May article, stop being afraid of what you are suffering. Oh, you want to see 1 Peter 4, 12 through 16 here, I know. The devil is going to throw some of you into prison to be tested, test with a view toward destruction, same as verse 2, for 10 days. Now, some say it's a historical thing that happened in Smyrna for 10 literal days. Some say 10 is the number of completion, so it means a complete number of days of persecution. Some go back to Daniel chapter 12, Daniel chapter 1, verse 12, to mean it's a short duration of time. Some say it's symbolic, some say it's literal. We just really don't know. Now notice it says, each one of you must prove to be faithful. This is a present middle imperative, emphasis on continual hanging in there ourselves. It's one of the continual emphasis of the perseverance of the saints. It's just all the way through here. 2:7, 2:11, 2:17, 2:25 and 26, 3:4 and 5, 3:11 and 12, 3:21. It's encouragement to hang in there. And I think we ought to hear that. You might want to see Matthew 24:24 and Galatians 6:9 for some other emphasis in the same area. Now, even if you have to die. Now, this have to die refers to the many martyrs that we know of from the history of Eusebius died in this place, including Potiphar. We are to hang on to the end. Luke 12, 4 and 5 says, don't fear them who can kill the body, but fear him who can kill the soul in hell. So that's the idea here. This death is mentioned again in Revelation 12, 11, and you might want to see that. If they hang in there, they're going to get the crown of life. We get the English word Stephen from this. It's a Stephanus, or a victor's crown. It's mentioned in 2 Timothy 4, 8, mentioned in James 1, 12, 1 Peter 5, 4. And then the same recurring phrase, but him who has ears and whoever conquers will not be hurt, strong double negative, by the second death. The second death is the idea of hell or eternal separation. You might well see Revelation 20, verses 6, 14, and Revelation 21, 8. Now coming to the next church, the church at Pergamum. Now King James has Pergamus, but the better manuscripts have a neuter term, which is Pergamum, okay? The one who is wielding the sharp double-edged sword. This goes back to chapter 1, verse 6. Now we know from the old, there's an Old Testament background to this, Isaiah 11, 4, Isaiah 49, 2. In the New Testament, it's a metaphor for the power and the penetratingness of the Word of God. You might want to see 2 Thessalonians 2, 8 and Hebrews 4, 12. Thus it says, the two-edged sword speaks as follows. I know where you live, implication of the word live permanently, where Satan has his throne. There have been several possibilities here. Some think it refers to the throne of Zeus that was located in a predominant place in this city. Some think it's the God Asclepius, the healing god, in the symbol of a snake. Some say because these temples were up on a high hill, the whole city looked like a throne when you approached it. But I really think what we're talking about here, again, is the concilia, or the seat of emperor worship that was found in this place. Now, notice where it says, yet you are clinging to my name. Probably Jesus is Lord, his character, his trustworthiness. They were hanging on to him. It mentions a man named Antipas. We know nothing about him except he's called a faithful martyred witness. Same title used for Jesus in Revelation chapter 1, verse 5. Later on, Tertullian says that he was boiled in a brazen bull, but we just don't know that. That's much later tradition. Now, notice it says, verse 14, yet I hold it somewhat against you that you have among you some who are clinging to the teachings of Balaam. Now, Balaam, of course, is a true prophet of God that we see that Balak called to somehow caused the children of Israel to stumble. God wouldn't let him prophesy, but he did give the man a way to do it, and that was to send the Moabite women down into the camp, and then God judged the Hebrew people for their idolatry. You might want to see Numbers 22:1 through 25:9 and Numbers 31:16, where this is mentioned in the Old Testament. Because the Nicolaitans are mentioned down in verse 15 and the Balaamites in verse 14, and they're very similar to what happens to the Jezebel, the prophetess, in verse 20, I think all three of these false teachings are related. They seem to be related with compromising with pagan culture. As they would worship these pagan deities, these feast days, the food was dedicated to these gods, and they had sexual immorality as a regular practice of worship. And I think that's what all three of these are connected with, really. Now, notice it mentions precisely the eat meat, sacrifice to idols, and commit immoral practices. And in verse 15, this other group of false teachers mentioned. So in verse 16 it says, so repent, aorist imperative, a decisive act of repentance, or else I will come quickly and make war upon them. These are members of the church Christ is going to make war on. This seems to be temporal judgment more than an eschatological second coming. Okay? Now it says in verse 17, that everyone who has ears, listen to what the Spirit says to the churches, and I will give to him who conquers some of the hidden manna. Now, what is that? Well, manna, of course, what God gave to the children of Israel in the wilderness wandering period. Some say it refers to God's provision in the New Age. We learn from the apocryphal book of 2 Baruch, chapter 29, verse 8, that they believed that manna would be given to those people who lived in the Messianic Age. Now, some other possibilities are that Jeremiah was supposed to have hidden the ark in Mount Nebo, and he would bring it out when the Messiah came, and the manna was hidden inside the ark in the jar along with Aaron's rod and budded. Now that would be an allusion to 2 Maccabees chapter 2, verses 4 through 8. Others say it just goes back to the idea of this end time period, a messianic banquet contest. And I will give him a white stone. Now this is called a tersa. It's a very wide kind of symbol in the ancient Near East. It could mean a ticket to a special banquet. It could mean the vote of an acquittal in a trial case. It could mean a stone given to an athlete when he won a race. Or it could be a stone given to a slave when he gained freedom. But because the messianic banquet context, it seems that a stone to enter the banquet is the idea. With a new name written on it. Now this new name, they have a new city, a new name, a new song, all the way through the book of the Revelation. There seems to be an Old Testament background to this. Exodus 28, verses 36 and following, Isaiah 56, 5, Isaiah 62, 2, and Isaiah 65, 15, talk about the new name written on believers. And then it says, which no one knows except the one who receives it. That may be connected with the idea that magic was involved in knowing the right name of deity, and no one knows Jesus' name but his followers. I'm not sure that's what it means. There's a possibility. Now, to the church at Thyatira. You know, it says, the Son of God. The only place in the book of the Revelation this title appears. It's usually the Son of Man has the same input. Here, I think the reason it's mentioned is because in verse 26, we're going to quote specifically Psalms 2, verse 9. And this Son of God may be an allusion to Psalms 2, verse 8, which sets the context of this whole message. Then it says, whose eyes are like coals of fire, and whose feet are like bronze refined in white heat. This seems to be an allusion to Daniel chapter 10, verse 6. The eyes, meaning Christ's knowledge of all things, and the metal feet, meaning Christ's stability. And I think that's the idea here. Now notice where it mentions, I know what you were doing. I know your love and faithfulness, your service and patient endurance. This church was very faithful and very active. I know that you are now working harder than you did at first, quite different from the church at Ephesus. But I hold it against you that you are tolerating that Jezebel of a woman who claims to be a prophetess. Now, this tolerating is present tense, which means it was a continual thing. Jezebel, of course, is an Old Testament term like Balaam to describe a false teaching. This happened to be propagated by a woman. Now, the Old Testament setting, it's 1 Kings 16, 31 and following. It was one of the daughters of the king of Tyre that was given to one of the kings of Israel and all the problems she caused. Now, some of the manuscripts, particularly manuscript A or Alexandrinus, has thy Jezebel. Some say it's the wife of the pastor, but I don't know if we can go that far. Notice she claims to be a prophetess, claims to be a teacher of God, but look, she's doing the very same things in verse 20 that the Balaamites and the Nicolaitans were doing, and that is eating meat sacrificed to idol and practicing immorality. So she's obviously a false teacher who's compromising with pagan culture. And because Thyatira had many of these trade guilds, it was probably these different patron deities of these different trade guilds in town. I have been given her time to repent, but she refuses to repent of her immorality. Verse 22, see, I'm going to lay her on a bed of sickness. Some say it's irony from her bed of adultery to a bed of sickness. I'm not sure that's true here. And let's see, unless she repent, there's a first class conditional with a future tense, and I will surely strike her children dead. Verse 23, obviously her followers, kind of like the way the word's used in 2 John, children meaning followers. So all the churches will know. Now here's the emphasis, that the message is for all of them, not just some. That I am he who searches men's innermost being. God knows our thoughts. He knows all about us. Christ knows what we think. This goes back to the Old Testament, several different passages. Proverbs 24:12, Psalms 7 verse 9, Psalms 26:2, Psalms 139:1, Jeremiah 11:20, Jeremiah 17:10. Several times in the New Testament, you'll see that in your notes. He's going to repay each one exactly what they've done. Notice that judgment's going to be on an individual basis. The rest has been very corporate. It's going to be on an individual basis. It's going to be connected to deeds. You might well see the white throne judgment of Matthew 25, 31 through 36. 46. Verse 24, they learn the deep things of Satan. Now, some think that may be the catchphrase of this Jezebel's false teaching. Others say, no, it's related to the Gnostic teachers, the deep things of God, meaning this emphasis on intellectual knowledge. Some say it's the emphasis on the mystery religions and their initiation rites. But I really think what we have here is probably an allusion, an antithetical allusion to the deep things of God that are mentioned in Romans 11:33, 1 Corinthians 2:10, and Ephesians 3:18. Now, notice it says, I have no extra burden to lay on you. Now, this shows the ones who were faithful were very faithful and very dependable, both service and theology. But keep your hold on, aorist imperative, what you have until I come. And there's emphasis on hanging in there in verse 26, to him who conquers and continues to the very end. The perseverance of the saints is a continuing theme throughout here. And then it continues, the works to him who conquers and continues to the very end of the works that please me. Now, I think the rest of verse 26 and verse 27 is a quote from Psalms 2, verse 8. And that's the allusion, I think. That says, he will govern them in verse 27. There are many allusions to Christ ruling in the book of the Revelation, chapter 12, verse 5, 19, 15, and again Psalms 2, 8, and 9. But there are also some allusions to that we will reign with Christ, Matthew 19, 28, Luke 22, 30, 1 Corinthians 6, 2, 2 Timothy 2, 12, Revelation 3, 21, 20, verse 4, and then in 22, 5, it says we'll eternally reign with him, which tells me this is not automatically a millennial reign. Now, let's mention about the scepter of iron, and he will shepherd them. Two very opposite metaphors, the gentleness, but the completeness of Christ's reign. Just as I have authority, as I have received from my Father, Jesus has all authority. Now, we'll see Matthew 28:18 and Philippians 2, 9 through 11. I will give him the morning star. Some say it's a metaphor for resurrection life, going to Revelation 22:16. Others say it's a metaphor for intimate fellowship with Christ, going to 2 Peter 1:19. Some say it's allusion to the Old Testament passages of Job 38:7 and Daniel 12:3, or the military Messiah of Numbers 24:17, or an antithetical statement from Satan being Lucifer, or the morning star, in Isaiah 14:12. Now, to the church at Sardis, the one who holds the seven spirits of God and the seven stars speaks as follows. You might want to see the seven spirits of God, chapter 1, verse 4. And for the seven stars, see chapter 1, verse 16, and particularly 1, verse 20. I know what you are doing. You have the reputation of being alive, but you are really dead. Now, maybe they were acting on past deeds, or maybe they thought they were alive, but they were really dead. This is speaking of a church now, not lost folks. In verse 2, we have a series of several imperatives, five imperatives. Some are in present tense, some are in aorist tense. Wake up, strengthen what is left. I have not found the thing you've done to be complete. These folks may be like Matthew 7, 21 through 23. Their works look good, but God wasn't pleased with them at all. So remember verse 3, another present imperative, what you have received. Maybe the deposit of the gospel truth. Maybe the Holy Spirit. I'm not sure which one. And continue to obey, present imperative. Now we'll see Luke 6, 46. And repent, aorist tense, a decisive act. If you do not wake up, I will come like a thief. This is quite often used for Jesus coming in the second at the second coming, Matthew 24:43, 1 Thessalonians 5:2, 2 Peter 3:10. But in this context, it seems to be temporal judgment coming to judge the church. Now, notice what it mentions verse 4. Yet I have in Sardis a few who have not soiled their clothes, who walk with me in white. Now, this thing about walking in white is used several times through here. What a person wore depended if he could be admitted to the temple. They're going to wear white here to symbolize that they are connected with God. White is used throughout the book of the Revelation for a symbol of righteousness or Christ or God's people. You might want to see chapter 3, verses 4 and 5, particularly chapter 3, 18, 6, 11, 7, 9, 7, 13 and 14, 9, 14. Okay? Now, Whoever conquers, that continuing on that, going to give three things to him who overcomes. He'll be clothed in white. His name will never be blotted out of the book of life. And I will own him before my Father. Boy, what a beautiful triad. Let's go back through that for a minute. Notice the idea, I'll never blot him out. We learn from history that when a citizen died, his name was taken off the rolls of the city. But this is the idea, strong double negative, our names will never be taken out of the book of life. From Revelation chapter 20, verses 12 through 15, there are two books. There's a book of life and a book of remembrances. In your notes, I've given you all the scriptures. Will never be taken out of God's book of life. Hallelujah. Notice it says, I will own him as mine in the presence of the Father and his angels. Boy, read Matthew 10:32 and the parallel in Luke 12:8. If we'll confess him before men, he'll confess us before his Father in heaven. Hallelujah, what a promise. Now, down to the church at Philadelphia, the Holy and True One. Holy is a title for Yahweh found in Isaiah 6, 2 through 5. And this concept of holy and true is found again in Revelation 6, 10. The ideal of true in Greek means true versus false. But in Hebrew, it means faithfulness or trustworthiness, and that's what I think it means here. Who carries the keys of David? An allusion to 2 Samuel chapter 7, the royal messiahhood of the one coming in David's line. Keys is the ideal of authority or ownership. Now, the specific allusion is from Isaiah 22:22, and you might want to look that up for how Jesus is going to let them in. Let them into what? Well, the context seems to imply the messianic banquet. Some say it's salvation, but I think it's the eternal kingdom that's being talked about here. He's opened a door that no one can shut. This idea of an open door may be the idea of missionary activity, because this church of Philadelphia was known for that, or opening the door of salvation to others, like the keys of the kingdom mentioned in Matthew 18. Now, when it says an open door, many times in the Bible, this speaks of an opportunity for spiritual service. Acts 14:27 and several other passages you'll have to read in your notes. Notice they have not disowned his name, obvious emperor persecution, and those who claim to be Jews, although they are not. Now, we learn that that Jew is not someone who's physically circumcised, but whose heart is circumcised. Romans 2:28 and 29. You might well see Galatians 3:29, Galatians 6:16 for this idea of spiritual Israel. Now, notice it says, "And I will make them come and fall at your feet." This is an obvious allusion to several passages in the Old Testament where the Gentiles were going to come and bow down to the Jews. But here the tables have really been turned, with the Jews rejecting Jesus as a Messiah, and now it's the Jews who are going to come to the Gentiles. You might want to see Isaiah 45:14, 49:23, and Isaiah 60:14. Now, some say verse 10, they have kept my message with patient endurance, and I will also keep them from the time of testing that's about to come upon the whole world to test the inhabitants of the earth. Some use this as a reference to the tribulation period. That may be true, because the inference is not just the church at Philadelphia, but the whole earth. And those who dwell upon the earth is a common metaphor in Revelation of unbelievers. You can see your notes for the many places it's used. Notice that God's going to keep them. Does this mean then take them out like a secret rapture, or go with them through the persecution? The context seems to say he'll go with them through the persecution, and I think that's significant. We can't be too dogmatic here, though. Our part is to hang on. God's part is to keep. Hallelujah. Notice where it mentions here I'm coming soon, verse 11. This is the idea, I think, that we have got to say that the book of the Revelation teaches that Jesus expected to come back, that he was coming back soon. You might want to see chapter 1, verse 1, verse 3, chapter 2:16, 22:7, 22:12, and 22:20. The Stephanos crown is mentioned here again, as you saw earlier. He's going to make them a pillar in the temple. We learn from the cultural setting that some very famous citizens had their name written on the pillars in these different temples in this town. The pillars, it's an earthquake area. Only the pillars were left after these quakes. It's a symbol of stability. The word temple here means inner shrine. Notice the new name, the new Jerusalem. All this new is characteristic of the book of the Revelation. And now for the last church, the church of Laodicea. God's called the Amen. Many think it goes back to Isaiah 65:16, where he's called the God of Amen. That may be true. He's a faithful witness. There goes back to Jesus in chapter 1, verse 5. The origin of God's creation, or the source. This is one of the strongest instances for the preexistence of Christ, and Christ being the agent of creation. See John 1, 3, 1 Corinthians 8, 6, Colossians 1, 15 and 18, and Hebrews 1, 2. Now, this lukewarm water comes from the idea that there was hot springs close to Laodicea, and lukewarm water is not palatable. They were also known as a banking center, a clothing center, and a medical center, and all three of those are brought out. They need to get gold from God, eye salve from God, and clothing from God in Christ, because theirs is all corrupt. It's an allusion to what they had in the local thing. Now, people whom I dearly love, I always reprove and discipline. There are many passages in the Old Testament, they're in your notes, as well as the New, particularly Hebrews 12:6, where those whom God disciplines know they're His children, and that's very important. Now, it continues then when it says, so keep from being earnest and once and for all repent, a very decisive repentance mentioned over and over. I'm standing at the door and knocking. This is not evangelism. This is a church that's supposed to return to God. It's only speaking of individual, because you have to come, you have to repent individually. There has been some corpus repentance, but this is individual repentance and restored fellowship. The idea about eating with Him is, I think it's a background, the Old Testament sacrifice, the peace sacrifice, where God symbolically ate with the worshipers. I think it's the idea of the word here is the evening meal. It was a leisurely meal, a fellowship meal. I think it speaks of the covenant idea. I think it's the messianic banquet. I don't think it's salvation here. And I will give to him who conquers the privilege of sitting on the seat with me in my throne. There's those emphasis we mentioned just earlier in the lesson about ruling and reigning with Christ. Just as I have conquered, you might want to see John 16:33. He has overcome. 1 John 5:4-5. Because he's overcome, we've overcome. Because he's taken his seat in the Father, 1 John 2:1, we're going to take our seat with him. Hallelujah. He's overcome, we've overcome. He's reigning, we're going to reign. Friends, this is that continual emphasis on the fact that the book of the Revelation is not just about the future, but about the spiritual realities of what God in Christ has done for us. That no matter what we're going through, persecutions or problems, God knows what we're doing. Jesus cares and intercedes for us, and he's going to work it out. Nothing just happens to God's children. God knows what we're going through. He cares. He wants to continue to refine us and discipline us to become us more like Christ. His judgment is not a sign of his anger, but of his love. God is focusing history toward a purpose. We need to hang in there. God is sovereign. It's all going to work out. You can trust me is the emphasis of the book of the Revelation. And these seven churches have set the stage in history for its historical relevance and its prophetic relevance for every age. Well, I've really enjoyed being with you. Please get the notes. They're very detailed. They'll help you on all the detailed scripture references I couldn't miss because I had to go so fast. God bless you. Have a good day. I'll see you again, same time, same place next week.